the Gentlementor. On the road.
Probably wondering why I'm videotaping bags of cars. Well, I'm not, because there's no tape in that camera, so, you're stupid.
Yeah.
And, because we passed through, there was a city limits of Charlotte sign, so I thought we might see something of Charlotte, get it, experience that.
But at least you got this truck.
Yeah.
That you can experience.
Warning, high Q.
High Q.
Anyway, Charlotte. Another Friday morning in Charlotte.
Or CLT.
This is quite a playlist.
Well, it was supposed to be a road trip playlist, but it's more like an 80s playlist.
It's like an 85, 86 playlist. It's like, yeah, I'm heavily vibing in Nostalgiaville. All those memories. Yeah, this came out shortly after we moved to Madison. It was like the end of that summer. So the song was all over the radio, so that always made me think of that. Steve Winwood, and you had the other guy, the St. Elmo's Fire song. Those were both 86. Oh, yeah. It's like a pretty narrow shot of road trip music. That's good. I dig it. Puts me in a happy place. Why don't you tell me about the inflation? We talk about the stock market.
Yeah. I read a bulletin from the Homeland Security website.
Really?
Yes.
What are they warning about?
Terrorism in the next 12 months.
What kind?
Domestic.
To the Grand Parkway.
I turned off the freaking camera. Man, every time. Never fails. Billy Grand Parkway, everybody. Billy Grand Parkway Farmers Market.
I watched the little 20-minute thing that Paramount did with Tom Cruise and James Coburn. Is it Coburn? To promote Maverick, the new movie.
Oh, okay.
But it was funny because they did a whole 2 days of flying in different airplanes. They did a scene where they were sitting on having
the dude from the show.
The dude from the show.
The little English guy that does the talk show. You said James Coburn. I'm thinking of the actor James Coburn. It's James Gordon.
James Gordon.
Gordon. Okay, now I'm with you. Woo! I'm like, special effects.
So he and Tom Cruise, they're sitting there and they cut to the scene and they're sitting by the fire talking, and Tom Cruise is like, so I was making cocktails, and then I was like, why don't we name the movie Cocktails? Or Cocktail. Little Rock Road. And then he said, and the funny thing about Mission Impossible is that the mission was possible.
Obviously.
Yes.
And several more words.
You got a Maserati coming up behind us.
Ew. And somebody drives a Maserati that lives out by us, because I always pass him when I'm coming back home. He's coming this way. Did you ever see Tropic Thunder?
No.
Tom Cruise is in it. It's probably the funniest thing I've ever seen him do. When I watch it, I don't even watch it for like Ben Stiller and Jack Black and Robert Downey Jr. and their actors making a war film. But he's like he's the high powered Hollywood producer guy. A very enjoyable character. In fact, when I first saw it, I didn't realize it was him for the first 15 or 20 minutes. I'm like, who is that? They've got him heavily made up. U.S. National Whitewater Center. That was one of the things I thought. They have a man-made whitewater rafting place.
That's what that is, isn't it?
Yeah. It's like a circle.
Yeah.
And there's like a big flotilla thing out in the middle. I'm like, that is crazy. A whitewater rafting park. Shooters Express. You're in a hurry to shoot something. Drive-through ammunition. In case you're wondering what the purpose of the shot is, it's hopefully you can see the hazy mountains. I guess they're not the Smoky Mountains, probably, aren't they? Smoky Mountains, way up there in the distance. That's a guy. got the on top view. Now we get the profile. Asheville 52. Lake Lure. I think that's where they filmed Dirty Dancing. I think that's where the resorty looking place was. If they filmed Dirty Dancing, it's actually Lake Lure, North Carolina.
Really?
Yeah.
You should look that up. I thought it was in Virginia.
Dirty Dancing, filmed at Lake Lure, August. Okay, yeah. 87, the blockbuster Dirty Dancing was released across there. Though set in the Catskills, it was shot entirely in Virginia, North Carolina. Okay, so it was Virginia, too. Okay.
But it was Lake Lure?
Mm-hmm. Many of the film's most famous scenes, including the lake lift scene with Patrick Swayze, lifts Jennifer out of the water, practicing her moves, the song Wipeout, the stairs on the mountainside were shot at Lake Lure. It's also where the golf course was, where she asked him for the money. And the Esmeralda Inn in Lake Lure was used for the interior dance shots. Now they host a Dirty Dancing Festival every year. Surprise, surprise. There you go. I think Virginia, they shot like the where the cabins were that the employees were. I know they had to do two different locations because they had to like one was off season for one and one was off season for the other. So. But I'm sure it's written all. Entering the Green River Gorge. Surprise. No, I'm not just filming guardrail. This is a thing.
7% green. There's the gorge.
It's gorgeous. So, Asheville, North Carolina. Home of the Biltmore House. The luxurious family home of George and Edith Vanderbilt is a marvel of elegance and charm, as magnificent today as it was more than a century ago. Faithfully preserved and filled with original furnishings, masterpieces of art, no other residence in America offers a more authentic and inspiring view of Gilded Age life, suggesting that the Vanderbilts and their guests are still at home.
Let's go. Cost to get in.
Sure. And everything.
I remember seeing that on America's Castles.
Mm-hmm. No. Screw them and their castle. Tickets start at $89.
You gotta be able to stay the night.
Shit, yes. Get a back rub or something. By comparison, the Elvis Experience Tour at Graceland, the top level is only $77.
Wow.
For $128, you get the Elvis Entourage VIP Tour. So, yeah. At Biltmore, I didn't expect that. I expected like $20. That's crazy.
That's crazy.
Are you guys constantly calling out the things your eyes are seeing?
Yes.
Except this morning was pretty quiet.
Well, it was quiet this morning, but...
We're heavy contemplation, though.
But yeah, Doug, normally we call out some of the things.
I warned you before we left, if it gets bad, just smack me, because I got a real bad habit of it. Like, I see a road sign, I got to say it out loud.
Yep, and he does. And so we're going to have to bring this conversation to a close, because we're about to go through a tunnel. And...
Okay.
That will definitely probably bring it to a close.
Yeah, probably. Unless they have cell phone things in the tunnel.
Ooh.
Because there was the one in Dallas, the tunnel that goes under some of the buildings downtown, has cell phone things in
it. This is the Tennessee Technology Highway or whatever.
Tennessee.
I saw that sign earlier.
Oh, yeah.
There's a sign you meant.
That's the nice thing about riding with Doug. I don't have to read the signs. He reads them out loud, so I can just keep my eyes on the road.
Do you have good eyes, Doug?
No, but I got some new glasses, and they're really helping.
Nice. I didn't know if you knew this, Doug, but you and I actually have the same eye condition. Our eyes are two different colors.
That's a condition?
Or was it?
Yeah, what is it called, Mark?
That was a privilege. What's it called?
Yeah, I think it's like I don't know. I'll have to look it up.
Mine aren't like radically different. They're just different shades, but they change color too from time to time. Like some days they're more green, some days they're more blue.
Well, I have one eye that's green and one eye that's blue.
Now my eyebrows and eyelashes are mismatched. They're completely different.
Heterochromia is what it's called.
I'm glad it's hetero. That's all I got to say.
It's hetero.
Yep. Heterochromia.
Well, that's not fair. Both my eyes are the same color. I guess I'll have to wear a patch on one eye just so I can say,
pirate chromia.
You could say that anyway.
Yeah, but it just sounds better when you got a patch on one eye.
Do it on the live stream. I'm here to grab your booty.
I'm here to grab your booty and steal hearts. There you go.
I'm here to grab...
Prepare to be banked. Walk the bank.
You beat me, too. I was going to say, I'm here to grab your booty and bank it.
Careful. Oh,
don't laugh too loud. Lori's going to get mad being too loud.
Oh, no, she laughed. Debbie was the one walking around in here. Second ago. Just doing laps. Okay. So, did you guys already go through the tunnel, or do you have an amazing vision?
No. There was a sign.
It promised a tunnel. We haven't seen it yet.
It said a tunnel, and it said we can't take any Class 1 explosives through the tunnel, which I don't think we have a Class 1
explosive. What is a Class 1 explosive?
I'm not sure. I don't know if the bullets in my gun are considered Class 1 explosives.
What are those Class 1?
I don't think so. I think that's like high explosive, like C4 dynamite,
plastic
stuff. They don't want you in that tunnel when you're looking. There's a dragon.
It's a dragon.
Sorry, dragon. I'm bound to point something like that out.
So, have you ever seen Mila Kunis's eye colors and how they're different?
No.
So mine are probably the most similar to hers that I've probably ever seen, because they're similar in color, but they are actually, like, you can see them. They are different colors.
Oh.
Yeah. Mine
are pretty
subtle. Picture, and I was like, I've actually never seen that picture.
I didn't know hers were different.
Uh-huh.
Of course, I didn't know yours were different either.
Yeah.
I don't know. Mine
Mark still hasn't been able to see it.
I can't see my eyes!
It's imaginary. Do you hear the rain?
I do.
Smoky Mountain rain keeps on falling.
Oh, hey. You can be very helpful in this matter.
Me?
How do you live with people that you disagree with?
You don't. You leave the state. So I'm kidding. Oh, how do I live with people that you disagree with? Not the people that are abusing you. I think that you live with people you disagree with the same way that you do life. I mean, you're not... There's not one person that you've ever come across that is going to believe the exact same thing as you do on everything.
All right. So let me raise the stakes a little bit.
Okay.
Let's suppose, put yourself in an imaginary situation. You're a mother.
Okay.
And your child has decided that they want to be gender fluid.
Okay.
And that's what they've decided to be. And you
are completely adamant about that. You want to make sure that they know that God is not for that. You are completely against that. But yet your husband is for it. He's like, whatever, let's just let the kid be the kid. That's what they want. That's what they are. But you're against it. Now, how do you and your husband continue to live and still raise a child when you have this very vast
that's very difficult, I think. How old is this child? Is it like an actual child?
14.
Let's say 14. Okay, sounds good.
Okay.
It's an actual child. No, this is a hypothetical situation. It's not an actual
child. No, I meant like in child age range. It's not like, everyone who has ever been, like, my parents still say that I'm obligated to obey them like a child under the age of 18 would be because I'm not married. So, I was basically more defining the term child as an actual minor, basically. Gosh, that would be so hard. I think the first thing I would do is I would go to my husband and be like, okay, so why do you want to handle this situation the way that you are? Why are you wanting to just sort of allow this? Do you agree with the child, or do you, is that your actual beliefs, or are you just more opting to avoid it and hands off? Like, why, what's your reasonings for that, number one? And then number two, I feel like if it was just, he just wanted to avoid the emotional work that it takes to kind of deal with that situation with the child. I don't know. As a wife, I would probably end up ultimately, after trying to kind of appeal to him several times, to be like, okay, can we get counseling on this? Can we try and work on this together? Because, this goes against something at my core, and now I feel like it's a husband and wife issue and not just a child issue, because the child's still a child. And at this point, the husband and wife being in unity on that is kind of important, because the child is still a child. It's still singularly their responsibility to make sure that they're okay. And if I'm truly believing that that's going to damage the child and he doesn't, then I feel like that is a marriage issue, because the child's still our issue. And so I would probably ask to get counseling so we could work through that as a couple to handle what we need to handle together, because we've still got a future with this. We still got to figure out how we're going to go about it.
Okay, so I like that approach.
That's your question.
Well, and I'll sum it up for you. Your approach is to seek understanding on why the disagreement is the way that it is.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's an important thing.
Yes, yes.
We're what do you call it? Warming up for our for our next topic.
Next series.
Mm-hmm.
Disagreement. We wanted to interview some people who are adamantly disagreeing with us about disagreements. So,
what are your stances on disagreements?
I disagree with them.
Yeah.
I think everyone should agree.
Everyone should agree with us.
Especially with me.
We're adamantly against disagreements.
I'm trying to remember. I saw this. I can't. Mark, did you and I watch this together? Where it was a post on Facebook, I think. Someone on social media. No. I think it was you. I think you showed me this dude where he was doing numbers, and he kind of was actually showing how many people actually died from COVID, and then how we were trying to expose COVID, but we were trying to hide the fact that War II even happened, and it was like showing comparison numbers of caskets all stacked up from COVID,
yes,
from the Spanish flu back in the day, from Stalin, from Hitler. Wasn't it you?
Yes, that's it's a guy that I follow, Metaball Studios. He does all these scale videos. But yes, they were stacked up coffins.
Well, that's grim.
I think it was what leader has killed the most people. That's the one we watched.
Who was it that ended up killing the most people? Wasn't it like some ancient pharaoh?
Something like that. No. It was some weird French guy or something. I don't know. I'll have to look it up.
Really?
Yeah.
That was French.
I don't know. Well, we never got through the tunnel. I guess it wasn't for us.
That was kind of a jip.
Yeah.
I was looking forward to that. The tunnel this morning was really cool.
So I'm a little curious as to you guys, your next podcast is going to be about disagreements. How are you guys concluding that? Like, what's your take on it?
Well, that's why we're doing the research.
Yeah. Our next podcast will actually be like the road trip podcast will be the next one.
Yeah.
Just trying to figure out different ways to come at it and talk about, you know, that you're kind of what you said at the beginning, you're going to disagree with people, so find some different kind of typological disagreements and then talk about how to deal with it.
Right. And then the disagreements, right. Because disagreements are different levels, then, you know, it depends on how you approach it. Is it a tension to be managed or is it a problem to solve? You know, if you can't figure out which end disagrees,
write that shit down.
If you can't
record it.
You can't decide which end the toothpaste tube should be squeezed from.
The cap,
the front end or the back end, and it, you know, that's not a marriage problem, that's a preference, and it's also a tension to be managed. It's not something you need to.
Are we still talking about toothpaste?
Yeah, it's a tension to be managed, but in the scenario like we gave you, that's a problem that probably needs to be solved.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like with my sister, I thought that our relationship, her problems with me. Were relationship problems, and I was trying to address it that way, and I was like, I'm willing to put in the work, I'm willing to, you know, to hear you out, and for us to work on this, and, you know, I'm willing for this, and then when we tried to kind of get into it, I was like, oh, actually, this is not something I can solve, this is not something that relationship skills can solve, because it wasn't a relationship issue. It was, you know, my sister just had to, you know, it wasn't something I could fix in my sister. She has to do the healing on her own, or she just has to, you know, she has to deal with those things on her own. So we're not going to agree on how that should be solved, because it's attention to be managed, not a problem to be solved, you know, until she might not ever change her mind on what she's, you know, how she's operating, what mode she's operating from. But you know, I can work with it as long as I realize, oh, okay, that's not my stuff. You know, I don't have to mess with that.
She's talking about a different problem with a different sister now.
I don't know.
Yeah, different problem with a different sister. Do you know how many siblings I have, Doug?
Seven.
No, I have 10.
10. That is a lot.
Yep, there is 11 of us. So yeah, a different sister. I could be talking about several.
So you guys can like play basketball.
Yeah, true.
I don't know, because I'm kind of a romantic at heart, as you, Mark, know. And it's kind of like, okay, you know, that's such an important relationship. It's such an important thing, who we are as individuals, is how, if we can keep that relationship pure, and if we can keep it honest and do, you know, work really hard at it, you know, it's really, really important. And so when people are just kind of normalizing that's not how it should be, it just hurts my heart. Because I have a big heart, it hurts.
She does have a lot of heartache.
I guess so.
In life. We're about to cross into Kentucky.
Florida.
Third state of the day.
Third state of the day.
Oh, that's really fun.
Cold Kentucky rain.
Are you guys getting out and taking pictures with the signs?
We mentioned it. We talked about it at first, but we didn't.
Yeah, and then the first sign that we crossed, we there was something about
rickety bridge.
Yeah, it was a rickety bridge. Yeah, it was over the Mississippi, and we thought, well, we probably shouldn't stop on the middle of the bridge over the Mississippi and take a picture. So it would have been very hazardous.
The pre-Civil War 2-lane Mississippi bridge didn't look like a good photo op.
So then once we kind of missed that, we never went back.
Yeah. Oh, here comes. We are trying to get on video.
We never went back to the idea of hitting all the...
I love you so much.
Kentucky. Welcome to Kentucky. And yes, it looks like Arkansas, except the mountains are bigger.
I thought I remembered it when I was little, when I went, that it reminded me a lot of Arkansas, but just more mountains, like you said.
Yep. And stormy. All right, I'll let you go.
All right, well, feel free to call me anytime you need to ask a question or something.
All right, we'll talk to you later.
Okay.
Bye.
Great to talk to you, Doug.
You
talk
too.
To bye-bye.
Be well.
Buckle up, phone down.
Okay.
Don't mess with Kentucky.
Here's me. Not messing with up, Kentucky.
Where's the racetrack? What's it called? Kentucky Downs.
Isn't that Louisville? All that stuff's Louisville. Kentucky Derby stuff.
The Kentucky Derby. It's in Kentucky, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Just want to make sure.
Churchill Downs. I think it's all that stuff's around Louisville. I shall say Louisville.
Louisville? Is that where they make bats?
The bats. Welcome to Kentucky. In pain, call Shane.
Get ready for some food soon.
I wouldn't be again.
You wouldn't be again?
I wouldn't be again.
Because it's appropriate.
Nice. But your ball changed the song. Remix.
There you go. I'm back. University of the Cumberlands. Small little university there.
Yeah.
7 lonely days and a dozen times ago, I reached out one night and you were gone. Don't know why you'd run, what you're running to. Oh, so all I know is I want to bring you home. Longing for a ride on this lonely Kentucky back road. I loved you much too long. I just wish I'd let you go. Never knowing what will grow. Kentucky rain keeps going down, and up ahead's another town that I'll go walking through.
Gets in through the holes.
Searching for you, cold Kentucky rain, cold Kentucky rain.
Still raining a little bit.
Yeah.
Still good.
Hell yeah.
There's a little gray bearded man sitting on a bench outside a general store. He said, yes, she's been here. But their memory wasn't clear.
Sounds like old dudes.
No way, the day before. Finally, with a preacher man who asked, were you bound on such a cold, dark afternoon? As he drove on through the rain, as he listened,
I explained.
And he left me with a prayer that I find you. Kentucky rain keeps falling now, and up ahead's another town that I'll go walking through. And the rain in my shoes, searching for you. Cold Kentucky. Kentucky rain. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, Kentucky rain.
Cumberland River. It's a bumpy river.
Cumberland Falls.
Cumberland Falls.
The Gentlementor. On the road.